Hello, my name is Patrick Boyle. Welcome back to my YouTube channel, where we're learning all about finance and derivatives. In today's video, we're going to learn all about swaps. Okay, so today we'll learn all about swaps. What are they? How do they work? Who trades them? And how do they pay out? Instead of going straight to a definition, let's just firstly discuss the idea of a swap. For some reason, a lot of students really hate learning about swaps as they think that they're complicated and confusing. But in truth, they're neither of these things. A lot of the material that we've already covered about options is a lot more difficult than swaps. There's no complicated formula for valuing swaps or anything like that the way there is for options. So don't worry too much about them and let's think about what they are. So when I teach this class at King's College or at Queen Mary, I often start out with a story and I say, well, let's imagine that you're a university student and in the final year of your degree. And after the exams, you go out with a drink with your best friend from college. And so the two of you go out and you say, well, we're just going to have one drink, right? We'll have one quick drink and then we'll go home, you know? But the night goes on, you know, you have two or three drinks, you have a few more, and things are getting a bit sloppy, you know, and you turn to your friend and you say, you know, you're the smartest person in the class. And your friend says, no, you're by far the smartest person. Everyone says that you are the best student in this degree program. You will be the most successful student. And you say to your friend, oh, no, you will be the most successful student. I know this better than I know anything. And so the argument goes on and on, and you know, you decide to have maybe another drink while you discuss it. And by the end of the night, you've come to an agreement with your friend. You've said to them, you know what? I have so much faith in you and how smart you are and how well you're going to do in life that what I'd like to do is enter into an agreement with you. What we'll do is we'll both go out and we'll get the best jobs that we can get. And what'll happen is that I, at the end of each month, will sign over my paycheck to you and you will sign over your paycheck to me. And because I have so much faith in you, I think I'll do better with that transaction than I will with just cashing my own paycheck. And your friend agrees and off you guys go. So then as time passes, what happens? Well, You get a really good job. You know, things work out for you. You've got a really top job at one of the top investment firms and, you know, you're making an awful lot of money. But of course, the problem is that you're not really making a lot of money because you're handing over your paychecks to this friend of yours. And your friend, of course, your friend actually was right. They had a lot of faith in you and they knew you'd get a great job. And so they just went and they got a job at a local restaurant. You know, they're flipping burgers at the restaurant. But they are receiving all of your big investment banking paychecks, you know, so you are at this point, we'll say a couple of years into it, you're the head of M&A at the biggest, best investment bank. And your friend is, there's still flipping hamburgers. So what happens? Well, obviously, you've lost out on that trade, but really, all that agreement that you entered into was just a swap where we took two cash flows that we didn't know what they would be, and we agreed at time zero that they were probably equivalent, and we exchanged them. And then, of course, after the event, we start to see what the two cash flows will be, and we see who wins and who loses in that transaction. Well, let's think a little bit more about it. So how do we price that? Once the swap is running, you know, once things are happening, we get to see the paychecks, and we'll assume that people's paychecks are just going to grow at the rate of inflation, for example, which is probably a reasonable assumption, maybe not early in your career, but for a lot of people it is. And so all we need to do to price this transaction is we just need to present value these two cash flows, and the difference between the present value of these two cash flows will be the amount you'd have to pay to get out of that transaction. Now, I guess I left out of that transaction, maybe you had made this agreement with your friend to do it for 5 years, you know. So if we're 3 years into it, in order to value it, you just have to look at the expected cash flows of your income over the next 2 years and their expected cash flows. And the difference between these is how much this swap transaction is worth. Okay, so now you know what a swap is and how it works, but let's see if we can come up with a slightly more formal definition for one. So a swap is a financial derivative in which two counterparties exchange the cash flow of one party's financial instrument for those of the other party's financial instrument for a period of time stated in the agreement. These cash flow streams are referred to as the legs of the swap. The swap agreement defines the dates when the cash flows are to be paid and how they are calculated. The cash flows are calculated over a notional principal amount. The notional amount is usually not exchanged between counterparties, it's just used as a reference from which the size of the two payment streams can be calculated. Usually at the swap's inception, at least one of the cash flows is an uncertain variable, such as a floating interest rate. The change in value for the uncertain cash flow will benefit one of the two parties financially. However, both parties may benefit overall, if not financially, by reducing financial uncertainty, as explained in my earlier video, which was called Should Companies Use Derivatives to Hedge? I'll link to that above. The very first swap was negotiated in 1981, when IBM and World Bank entered into a swap agreement. Since then, swaps have become one of the most heavily traded types of derivatives in the world. Interest rate swaps can be most easily understood as an exchange of loans. Consider two parties that have taken out loans of equal value. The first has borrowed at a fixed rate and the other at a floating rate. Both would like to balance their portfolio to limit risk. The two then agree to exchange their loans or swap interest rates. They might be doing this as a hedge to reduce their overall interest rate risk or to speculate on the future direction of interest rates. The principal amount of the two loans is the same, thus there's no need to exchange principal, leaving only the quarterly cash flows to be exchanged. The party that switches to paying a floating rate might request a premium or offer a discount on the original fixed borrower's rate, depending on how interest rate expectations have changed since the inception of the original loans. The original fixed rate plus the premium or minus the discount would be the equivalent of a swap rate. So, what is the commercial need for swaps? The normal commercial operations of many businesses lead to risks associated with interest rates or foreign exchange. We'll take, for example, a US savings and loan bank. Savings and loans accept deposits and pay a floating rate of interest on them. They then lend those deposits out as home mortgages. In the United States, home mortgages are typically fixed interest rate loans as opposed to the floating rate loans in the United Kingdom. As a result, a US-based savings and loan bank can be left with fixed rate assets and floating rate liabilities. This would lead to losses in a rising interest rate environment. To escape this interest rate risk, the savings and loan bank could use the swaps market to convert either their liabilities to fixed rate or their assets to floating rate. Initially, interest rate swaps helped corporations manage their interest rate risk exposures. However, because swaps reflect the market's expectation for interest rates in the future, swaps also became an attractive tool for other fixed income market participants, including investors, speculators, and banks. So, what is a plain vanilla swap? The term plain vanilla, when used in finance, usually signifies the most basic or standard version of a financial instrument. Plain vanilla is the opposite of an exotic instrument, which is a term used to describe a more complex security. The most common type of swap is known as a plain vanilla interest rate swap, which involves one counterparty paying a fixed rate to another counterparty while receiving a floating rate indexed to a reference rate like LIBOR in return. By market convention, the counterparty paying the fixed rate is the payer, and the counterparty receiving the fixed rate is the receiver. See the diagram on screen right now, which shows the two counterparties and the cash flows of a swap. The notional principle is an amount used as a basis for calculations. It is not actually transferred between the two counterparties. If, for example, the notional principal is $1 million, this then allows us to calculate the amount of the payments based on the two interest rates. For each exchange, the floating rate is set at the beginning of the period and paid at the end of the period. In order for a swap to be valued at zero at inception, the present value of the two legs of the swap must be equal. If you calculate the net present value of the two cash flows, the correct fixed rate is the one at which the two cash flows have an equal present value. Okay, so let's look at an example. Suppose two companies, ABC and XYZ, agree to an interest rate swap. ABC agrees to pay a fixed rate at 4% and XYZ agrees to pay a floating rate at LIBOR. The notional principal is $100 million. Payments are semi-annual and the maturity is 3 years. You can see that swap diagram on the screen right now. At the outset, we don't know who will win since we don't know the path that LIBOR rates will actually take in the future. We do know that there are 6 cash flow exchanges and that at each point ABC will pay XYZ $2 million. Assume now that the 3 years has passed. The table showing on screen right now shows how the swap worked out. Note that the notional principal in this example, $100 million, does not change hands at any point between the two parties. It would make no sense for them to wire each other an identical amount of money at the outset. It's just the figure upon which the individual interest rate calculations are based. Note that the interest rate swap allows the counterparties to do the same thing as the savings and loan bank mentioned earlier, that is, to change borrowings from fixed to floating or vice versa. In the example, ABC switched its borrowing from floating to fixed, believing interest rates would rise, and XYZ switched its borrowing from fixed to floating, believing that rates would fall. So let's now learn a bit about the interest rate swaps market. A significant industry has grown in order to facilitate swap transactions. Initially, investment banks would match counterparties and charge them a fee. Over time, they moved to a model where they make markets in interest rate swaps and would charge a spread. The spread charged compensates the dealer for the risk of counterparty default, the risk of mismatched entry timing to each leg, and provides a profit. Dealers often have a portfolio of swaps to manage and can find themselves exposed to the very risks their customers are trying to avoid. There are many market participants who transact in swaps. Swap brokers serve as information intermediaries. They have a number of potential counterparties in their contact list and stand ready to find a suitable counterparty for a swap upon demand. The broker will protect the identity of the interested parties until they have found a very likely counterparty. For their services, a swap broker receives a fee from each of the counterparties. Swap dealers serve as financial intermediaries and fulfill all of the roles of the swap broker, but they may also take risk positions in swap transactions by becoming an actual party to the transaction. Usually, the swap dealer will take a risk position in order to facilitate the trade of the initial customer, but then they'll quickly seek to offset that risk in the market. The swap dealer will charge a spread, as shown on the screen right now. Most swaps are traded over the counter, but some types of swaps are also traded on exchanges, such as the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, the CBOE, the Intercontinental Exchange, and Eurex. So, who trades swaps then? Let's look at 5 different groups. Number 1, company treasurers. Companies can set up swaps to hedge their interest rate exposure or to more closely match their assets or income stream, as explained above. Number 2, speculators. Swaps give fixed income traders a way to speculate on movements in interest rates while reducing the cost of long and short positions in treasuries. Instead of buying a treasury bond to speculate on a fall in interest rates, a trader could receive fixed in a swap, which gives a similar payoff should interest rates fall, but does not require the investor to put up as much capital. Number 3, Portfolio managers. Interest rate swaps give fixed income portfolio managers the ability to quickly add or reduce the duration of their portfolio. They give portfolio managers a way of adjusting interest rate exposure and offsetting the risks posed by interest rate volatility. Long-dated interest rate swaps can be an effective tool in liability-driven investing, allowing portfolio managers to increase the duration of a portfolio where the aim is to match the duration of assets with that of long-term liabilities. Number four. Risk managers. Financial institutions are usually involved in a huge number of transactions involving loans, derivatives contracts, and other investments, all of which can expose the institution to interest rate risk. This risk can be managed using swaps. Number five. Bond issuers. When corporations decide to issue bonds, they usually lock in an interest rate by entering into swap contracts. That gives them time to go out and find investors for the bonds. Once the bonds are sold, they can exit the swap contracts. The swap contracts will have hedged the interest rate risk between the sales pitch for the bonds and the actual sale. The importance of swaps in markets. Currency swaps originated when foreign exchange traders entered these agreements to work around British controls on the movement of foreign currency. The first interest rate swap was negotiated in 1981 between the World Bank and IBM. IBM at the time had large amounts of Swiss franc and German Deutschmark debt. IBM and the World Bank worked out an agreement in which the World Bank borrowed dollars in the US market and swapped the dollar payment obligation to IBM in exchange for taking over IBM's Swiss franc and Deutschmark obligations. The swap market has grown immensely since then. The notional dollar value of outstanding interest rate swaps globally was $318 trillion at the end of 2017, according to the Bank for International Settlements. The swaps market gave rise to ISDA, the International Swaps and Derivatives Association, the global trade association that created the core documentation for the over-the-counter derivatives world. I'll probably do a video on the ISDA Master Agreement sometime soon. Swaps today are easily the largest part of the derivatives world by notional values outstanding. So that's it. You made it all the way to the end, so do hit the like button. And if you want to see more content like this, hit the subscribe button. Comment below if there are any additional topics you'd like to see me cover in these videos. Tune in tomorrow to learn about currency swaps. See you then and have a great day. Bye.